Oh, okay, folks.
Hey, Jay. How are you doing? Good to see you.
Good morning.
Are you ready for this?
Here. Yeah, are you ready?
Absolutely. That's right. He's born ready.
Good morning, everybody. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. We're delighted to have you here this morning. My name is John Hamre, the president of CSIS, and just delighted to welcome you. There are too many problems in the world, and I think we ought to be starting looking at solutions in the world, and I think that's what we're going to do today. And I think that this should be a source of a great deal of optimism and energy and hope, and that's what we're going to spend our time together today, digging into a very interesting topic, and I want to say welcome to all of you. You're going to be a very important part of the success of this rollout by your interaction with the panel and with the speakers that are here today. And so I count on all of you to be very actively engaged. So please, make this should be something very vibrant, and I think it will be. If I were to tell you that over the last several months, scientists have discovered an enormous energy source for the world. And the best news is that this enormous energy source is located in the poorest countries in the world, and it's just there ready to be tapped. And if we tap it, this energy source is going to double and triple the GDP growth in these countries. You know, this would be global news, absolutely global news. And that's what it is. We do have that. We haven't thought about it this way. We've tended to think, I'm a security guy, you know, it's my problem. So we tend to look at unemployment as a problem. And it's about time that we start looking at this large reservoir as an enormous resource. A resource that could transform this world to a much, much better place if we're thoughtful and creative about it. That's what we're going to explore today. That's what this is about. Now, if you're going to tap into a new energy source, you have to know something about it. You know, you have to understand it. You have to characterize it. You know, we don't drill a well, you know, into a reservoir without studying the geology of that well to know how do we do it safely, how do we do it effectively, how do we get maximum output. So we need to understand the geology of it. So we need to understand the geology, the topography of this marvelous new energy resource that's all around us. And that's what this wellness index, youth wellness index, is trying to do. This is just a starting point. We have to understand it's a starting point. But it's a starting point for something really important, really big. And it's with that mindset that I would like to invite all of you today to engage with our panelists who are going to be digging in and exploring this wonderful new topic. Let me say a very special thanks to our partners on this. The International Youth Foundation, of course, was the creative spark to imagine the possibilities of this. And Hilton International made it possible. And this is unusual, to be honest, because there are very few corporations that would see a much larger underlying strategic force as being something that they should make an investment in. And if you think about it, the really great strategic issues of our day, it's about energy, it's about water, it's about untapped human capacity. Those are really the strategic forces. It's hard for an old defense guy to say, you know, because we like to think about our bombers and stuff, you know. But what's really powerful is these resources that could transform the world that we know. And we have an opportunity to get into that with these colleagues. So I welcome all of you. I want to say thank you to our partners, our friends. Nicole, you've done a fabulous job. You and Dan have done a fabulous job. And I think we should get on with the real program. I'm just ornamental, but I didn't want to say thank you. And I'm glad that you're all here today. Thank you very much.
Nice way to frame it.
The world's population today is under 25. One in every four people is between the ages of 10 and 24. These approximately 1.8 billion young people comprise the largest youth generation in human history. In some countries, young people are nearly 40% of the population. Roughly 85% live in developing and emerging economies and fragile states. Some view this demographic group as a challenge, but there's greater opportunity if their talent and resources are harnessed to spur growth and create vibrant, peaceful communities. This first-ever Global Youth Wellbeing Index examines how youth are faring globally and compares how they're doing across six interconnected areas of their lives. 30 countries representing nearly 70% of the world's youth are ranked from high well-being to low. Overall, this inaugural index finds the large majority of the world's youth live in countries at or near the bottom of the well-being rankings. However, in several countries, Indonesia for example, youth are often optimistic about their current status and their future, in spite of their environment. And on the other hand, young people in wealthier countries such as Russia often have more negative outlooks. Young people in richer countries like Australia and the UK tend to have higher levels of well-being than those in less wealthy nations. But money doesn't always buy youth success. Spain scores well overall, but high youth unemployment is a huge problem. Similarly, the US lags in youth health and citizen participation. Conversely, Vietnam's results demonstrate how youth may be well served even when resources are constrained. And nations ranking lower in well-being may score high in specific areas. For example, India and Tanzania rank near the top in citizen participation. On average, across all countries, youth are strongest in health and weakest in economic opportunity. Now is the time to invest in strategic policies and programs that engage and equip youth to be productive and reach their aspirations. If this transformative generation thrives, so do we all.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hamre. It's really a pleasure to see you all today. I'm Nicole Goldin. I'm the director of the Youth Prosperity and Security Initiative here at CSIS and had the privilege to lead the Global Youth Wellbeing Index project with our friends and partners at IYF and Hilton Worldwide. You're going to hear a little more from me later about some of the more details of the index, fleshing out the video we just saw a little bit. But for now, to really get us started and to help set the stage, it's my privilege to ask our esteemed plenary panelists to join me on stage. Our moderator is Alyona Minkovski. She is a host with Huffington Post Live, or HuffPost Live, as they say. We have Chris Nassetta, who is the chairman and CEO of Hilton Worldwide. My friend and colleague, Mr. Bill Reese, the president and CEO of the International Youth Foundation, and of course my colleague, Kath Hicks, is the senior vice president, the Kissinger chair, and the international security program director here at CSIS. So welcome you to the stage for what I know is going to be a very engaging conversation to kick off our event. Welcome.
Right. Can everyone hear me? So good morning, everyone. I want to thank CSIS, first of all, for letting me participate in the launch of this first ever Global Youth Wellbeing Index. Technically, I'm a little aged out of what counts as youth here, but thanks a lot. No, I'm just joking. But it doesn't mean that I don't still relate and understand that this is something that matters to all of us. It doesn't matter how old anyone is, right? Because, put it quite simply, this is about the future. And so when you use that figure, I think that the 1.8 billion young people aged between 10 and 24 in the world today are the largest youth generation we've ever seen. I think that both offers a lot of hope, and it also can be a little terrifying. It makes the challenges that lie ahead seem all that much more daunting. And so I think that it's incredible to see what young people are doing today. You look at a place like Silicon Valley, you look at the technologies that these young tech geniuses are creating that are helping us connect with everyone around the world. And you know, they're becoming some of the youngest billionaires and billionaires, and most of us don't even think twice about it. We just download an app on our smartphone and don't realize how much it's really changed things. But we also know that young people have disproportionately been affected by the global financial crisis, that more than half the young people in the world are either unemployed or underemployed, and this is leading to both social unrest, protest movements, revolutions, and these can be very tricky waters to navigate. And of course, this doesn't even start to get into what it's like, I think, for young people who live in an environment where fear and violence are pervasive every single day. It doesn't matter if it's a drug cartel or a suicide bomber or a drone strike, you can imagine that that's going to change the way that you develop and what your opportunities are that lie ahead. So I think that it's really great that there's something that is trying to look at the way, these varying ways that young people around the world live, and trying to piece together some of that data to see what people can do together, what young people can learn from each other. And I think that it really is fundamental that young people are involved in this process, right? We're not just talking about them, but making sure that they're part of the process of changing the future. So I think that this Youth Wellbeing Index, Global Youth Wellbeing Index, can be a good tool to foster that. So enough for me, I'm sorry. You're here to hear the panelists. But I would love to start by just hearing a few opening remarks from each of you as to why it is that your organization is participating here and why you think that this index is important. So Chris, perhaps we could start with you.
Yeah, happy to start. First, a big thank you to CSIS and my friends at IOIF, where I serve on the board and have for a number of years. This is the culmination of a number of years of work, obviously, to arrive at this, what I think is a very important day. And from my point of view, clearly one of the most important issues that we're dealing with in the world today. In fact, we were talking back in preparation for coming out to have the discussion that, you know, having participated in the World Economic Forum over the years and having recognized with my work with Bill and just through our business that this is, you know, certainly one of the, you know, I think the biggest issue we're dealing with in the world today. It hasn't been an issue that really, you know, has been discussed around the world the way, in my mind, it should be, in the sense of really getting governments and civil society and business, which is why I'm here, to really think about the issues and figure out how to really attack not just the problem, but as John, I think, said so well, the opportunity. So I think this, you know, this is an important day for lots of reasons, but not the least of which is really, you know, starting to make sure that, you know, that we're helping assist the dialogue to try and address the issue. And when you think about WEF and other forums now, this has really moved to the top of the agenda. So it's amazing to be here. From our point of view, I'll speak for business, as we have subject matter experts here that can speak to it from a different perspective. And it's a very straightforward perspective that I have. One, as was already discussed and people in this room are familiar with the issue, there is a huge problem. Now, I'll talk, there's also an opportunity, as John articulated so well, but today we have 75 million youth around the world that are unemployed. And so what does that mean in a simple way? And you mentioned it, Lana, in your opening comments. You have youth that don't have a line of sight to something better, right? And I see it all the time. I see it as I travel the world for a living. We're in 100 countries around the world, and we employ a lot of youth. And you can just see, and we know from Arab Spring and other things that are going on in the world, that a lot of the problems that we're seeing are just, you know, I hate to say it this way, but people have too much time. They don't have a view that there's something better for them, and so they have time to sit around and think about things that maybe aren't that productive. Importantly, and as John already covered, there's a huge economic impact to have, you know, 75 million youth that are not engaged in the economies around the world that are helping drive growth and prosperity and more opportunity in those markets. So there's clearly a huge problem. There's an opportunity, and I'll speak a little bit. You know, I'm in the hotel business, travel and tourism business, so maybe the risk of talking about our business a little bit, but it does relate very directly. There's both an opportunity and a necessity for us to be involved. The opportunity is travel and tourism is one of the biggest industries on Earth, 9% of global GDP. Travel and tourism is 1 in 11 jobs in the world. The best estimates are that travel and tourism is going to generate 75 million. It happens to coincidentally match up with 75 million unemployed, but 75 million new jobs.
Problem solved. In
the next 10 years. Well, they'll probably be, if we don't do something about that, 75 million unemployed is going to grow. But yes, maybe problem solved. So there's a tremendous opportunity to match that up. We can talk about later how we do that with sort of getting a better match of skills, but there's tremendous opportunity. I would say, from my point of view, why I'm on the stage, why we were so interested in partnering with CSIS and IYF, and why I'm so involved with Bill and his team, is that it's a necessity too, right? So I am running a business, and why I do care. I'm a father of six daughters. I have a lot of youth around my house, and I care about these issues because I care about opportunities in the world generally. It's also a business necessity in the sense that if you look at where we're growing, all this 75 million new jobs, all of the growth in travel and tourism, not all of it, but a lot of it is disproportionately in exactly the same places, the emerging markets, where you have these huge problems of unemployment and skills mismatch. And we need the youth to be employable to deliver service to our guests as we grow in those parts of the world. And if we don't do it, whether it's South Africa, we're working with IYF, or Saudi Arabia, or India, or where the list goes on and on and on, we won't succeed, right? So it's actually a business necessity. Now, the Wellbeing Index, which is the culmination of an amazing partnership and hundreds of people's work to get to this day, again, a very simple philosophy, and then I'll turn it over to others, which is you can't manage what you don't measure, right? So when I think about making a business decision that we're gonna move into a new country or a new region of the world, we do a lot of analytical work to understand, what kind of capital resources, human resources do we need to allocate, how do we do it to maximize the opportunity for success. And we do a huge amount of research, there's a lot of data involved, and we make judgments. Hopefully we make good judgments. But those judgments are based on a, sort of data-rich environment. I think when you really think about these issues that are, been around for a while but have not been at the forefront, there's been a massive lack of transparency and data with which to make good investment decisions, whether that's human capital or financial capital. And so the Wellbeing Index is the start of that, right? And we need a lot more data, and we have to expand it beyond 30 countries. There's a lot more work to do. But it's an amazing launch into the next layer of creating transparency so that it's all of governments around the world working with civil society and increasingly trying to engage the business community around the world into it, that we can make resource allocation decisions that make good sense to attack the problem, which is not the same in every region of the world, as you're going to see when we're done.
We'll see a lot of that in the report.
Yes.
Thanks, Chris. We have a lot to cover here. Bill, let's hear from you.
Well, Chris has well stated the business imperative, and then maybe a parental imperative if you've got six to get employed. I've only got four with the same worries. But and thank you for John telling us that the six and four are resources and not problems.
I've been trying to articulate to them they have a bit of a skills mismatch.
Yeah. But we've got a mission imperative at IYF. Our mission is only dealing with teenagers and young adults. And we were born about 24 years ago, just before they started talking about this youth bulge. Now, the youth bulge can become a security, an economic, and humanitarian worry, and even maybe a disaster. And it can become that resource for development and change that John talked about. And we shouldn't be Pollyanna about this, but he's absolutely right. When you look at things as optimistically, you bring different solutions to the problem. We have believed at IYF for years that effectiveness, scale, and sustainability, and who can be against any of the three of those, but are at the core of what development practitioners ought to be doing. And for us, effectiveness means then investing in proven practice programs, methodologies, curricula, strategies that get at results that are measured, that are time-bound, that are compared to other data sets. You have to know what you're doing. Well-intentioned, I think this will work, isn't enough in today's world, in any sphere, but let alone when you're talking about this cohort that is the largest cohort of young people, percentage-wise and in numbers in the history of the world. So we have to invest effectively. If we don't get to scale with our solutions, we're just then sort of tinkering around. And there are places for pilot projects and small, innovative, new things that you try, but you have to then evaluate them and figure out if it's worth doing, then let's go to scale. And sustainability, to me, is the sort of the flip side of scale. You don't get sustainable if you don't get to scale. And if you get to scale and can't be sustainable, and sustainability isn't just who's going to give you a grant for 3 years and then who will pay for years 4, 5, and 6. Sustainability is policy. Sustainability is capacity building. It is about resources, but it's about political will and getting that issue higher up on the flagpole. And Chris is absolutely right. At the Clinton Global Initiative, at Aspen, at the World Economic Forum, at all these great places and think tanks like this, that have been talking about the world's problems for a number of years, youth are not usually there. They've gotten up there recently, but more about woe is me, what the hell are we gonna do about it, rather than solution oriented. So an index for us is precisely a tool, and it's not our index, it's gonna be yours. We hope that governments, NGOs, civil societies, business, core business, their CSR and philanthropic programs, the big donors, the small donors, the faith-based folks, when they think about youth, could they then look at an index and even use the index in their own context to say, of all these domains that Nicole will talk about, and the domains, I must tell you, track precisely with the World Development Report of 2007, and its lead writer is going to be on our respondent panel, Manny Jimenez. No one better to talk about this later in the morning. They talk about, I still think, even though 2007 can sound like eons ago, it's still the best single document on youth development. It talks about youth development as transitions from childhood to adulthood. And the transitions are through education, are through health, through citizenship, through employability or gaining those skills to get a job and keep a job. Those are the domains of our index. And those domains can tell us where to invest intelligently. And that could be a host government, because even in some of the poorest countries of the world, their largest expenditure is in education. It's just not being well spent. But it's the expenditures of foreign aid agencies, of businesses, of investors, of CSR programs, of philanthropies. How can we steer resources? And resources aren't just money, too. It could be intellectual property. It could be, of course, the capacity building of the right institutions to do these things. But how can we, as business, civil society, and then to have married with a major think tank here whose business is about international relations, development, and security, to look at this not as youth as a nice, interesting sideshow over here, a special interest group, but a core piece of what we're talking about. We think this index then can help us all invest better and have better results.
Thanks, Tom. Kathleen.
Let me add my voice to those applauding the effort to bring the index together. For the security community, I think it's incredibly important, and it highlights many of the factors that we look to think about where states and regions are headed, what their trajectory is. So the index, particularly as it grows over time and is populated more data-rich over time, will be incredibly valuable to the security community. I think for the broader debate or discourse in the public about what it means to have youth bulges, also it provides that granularity that's really lacking in that discussion. And that's been highlighted, I think, by everyone here. So I would just say that, you know, it is absolutely the case that it's a two-edged sword. There is a huge potential in the youth in the world, and it's really the inability to realize that potential that leads to security failures. Secretary Clinton, then Secretary Clinton in 2012, after the ouster of the Tunisian president, went to Tunisia and spoke about the importance of youth, and she said the world ignores you at its peril. And I think that that's true. And as you start to flesh out through the index the particulars of economic disaffection, combined with a lack of participation in democracy, combined with large numbers of youth, you start to see the factors that can, don't always, but can build together to create real problems for the world community. So I'm going to stop there because I think most has been said, and I'll turn it back over to you.
Thank you. One of the things that this is actually addressed in the report itself too, but I would love to hear more specifically, Bill, from you about this, is it even right to just bundle the youth together into one group? We know that it's not a monolithic group. We know that based on your gender, your geographic location, your economic opportunities, things can be very different from people there. So are there any downsides to you for making something that is a global youth well-being index that maybe isn't taking into, that isn't paying attention to specific particulars that really split up these different groups depending on, like I said, socioeconomic status, where they live, et cetera?
No, I don't think there are any downsides at all. There are certainly within the data, when you talk about 30 countries or 70% or 200 countries and 100% of the youth of the world, we're gonna wanna dig deeper into actual segments of youth, younger youth, middle-aged youth, older youth, young adults, and culturally and politically and demographically, countries define youth in very different terms, 12 to or 14 or to 18 to 21 to 29. Africans look at youth until their mid-30s. I guess my kids in their mid-30s would still like to be called youth, so I would pay some of their credit card bills. But but that I don't think is important, because the index will help us compare and frame some needs and look at countries as where they're doing better, where they have some gaps, and then we can do compare across countries, not to name and shame at all, but to learn from this so we invest better. Governments need to do that better, locally, statewide, federally, in the larger countries. More and more the solutions are coming at the local levels, and we need to give tools to people to figure out those education, health, and other components of wellness. And certainly a young person's aspirations for the future and their hope are not as measured easily and scientifically as other things, but terribly important. Queen Rania of Jordan is on our board of directors. And she was one day talking about the hope gap. This was about the time when we were all talking about the digital gap. And I wanted to pull her out more, what she meant. I thought I knew, but I wanted the other people in the room to hear her. And she was basically saying, a young person who has no one in their family who's ever had a job in the real formal economy doesn't have any role models. Why stay in school? Why play by the rules? Why try to get ahead? Why try to work hard with the payoff that's coming later on? Young people need a sense of hope, and we've built in some psychological insecurity, personal security and aspirational type things into the index, which can some people might say will make that a little fuzzy because that's not as clear as how many people actually graduated from sixth grade. But though that part of the index is also very important because young people have to buy into their own futures to have a sense. We wrote a paper, and Lori Harnick is here from Microsoft and will be on the respondent panel too. We wrote a paper 2 years ago called Opportunity for Action, Preparing Young People for 21st Century Livelihoods. And we see the Hilton paper we wrote a year ago with Chris and his company, Creating Opportunities for Health, for Youth in Hospitality, that 73 million jobs that are out there, and this index as being two very clear, concrete action items to push the agenda forward. The Microsoft paper said this is a global problem. It is different. The statistics and the cultural and economic and political are all different, but this is a problem that no country in the world is immune from. And just look at Spain. What's happened to them in the last couple of years?
I agree with everything Bill just said, and I think your question is a great one, and one that's worth emphasizing a little bit, an angle on it, which is I lightly referenced in my introductory comments, which is we're not trying to say in the launch of this index that we have everything we need yet, okay? This is a place to start, like a lot of things. And part of the issue is, and I think I said it, is there's just a general lack of transparency. So I couldn't agree more. There are a number of demographic differences, whether it's age, gender, sexual orientation, whatever it might be, religious orientation, that are subsets of all of these things. So I think there is a risk in homogenizing youth. The point of the index is not to do that. The point of the index is to create a dialogue, to use it a bit as a megaphone to get civil society, governments, and business to work together to figure out in a very granular way exactly what you're talking about, so that as we think about problems in various regions and countries, and even within regions within countries, what are the specific solutions that address the most dramatic problems? But the only way, getting back to you can't manage what you don't measure, that we can do that is bringing more visibility to this issue and getting all the parties that that should be at the table to focus on more data, more information and data upon which, with which we can make resource allocation decisions that focus on that type of granularity. It's not, I mean, this is a great start. It gives us a certain level of granularity that is better than anything that exists as far as we can see today. But my own view is there's a lot further to go to really do this properly.
To that point, Chris, how is it then that you are going to convince other businesses that while the untapped resources are there, and this seems obvious because the numbers are there, right, in terms of the amount of people and the amount of youth that could be employable, as you said, right?
Yeah.
Your company is planning on employing, what, 1 million, or connecting, preparing, and employing 1 million young people by 2019. How is it, though, that you convince other businesses to invest their money in countries and in parts of the world where there is a lot of instability?
I think that the honest answer is it's going to be hard to convince some, okay? That's just the truth. But I think there are many that are getting engaged in this issue, not just hospitality or travel and tourism, but across a broad spectrum of industries. As I said, you know, it was a major topic of discussion when I was in Davos, across a broad range of industries. And I think the way with business, because you know, people that are running businesses, as much as they might care about the broader implications for society and cultures around the world, they're fiduciaries that are there to ultimately, they're paid to maximize the value of their businesses and the growth and profitability. That's what they're there to do, and they have to always sort of look through that lens. I think the practical reality is not just for my business or broader travel and tourism, but across all industries, it's a necessity. And I think when you really sit down, and I do, and talk to other CEOs, and Bill does very, very frequently, you recognize that today, while a few years ago they didn't maybe understand the issue, that they're running up against it every day as they're trying to run their businesses and grow their businesses, particularly as most of the global businesses around the world are indexing to higher growth in the emerging markets. And so it's not happening as quickly. Short answer, it's not happening. Not everybody's gonna buy in. It's not happening as quickly as you'd like it to happen. But I think the trajectory's pretty steep at this point, and I think it's out of simple necessity that people are realizing I can't do what I need to do either in the service business or highly skilled job. It really doesn't matter. In all levels of employment, youth need to be engaged in the process. And CEOs, I think, are starting to realize that. And those that are really, you know, have a vision in terms of the long-term potential and opportunities in their business, I think will very quickly sort of rally around this.
Always important, right? Play the long game, not the short game. Kathleen, I think that one of the issues that is constantly not addressed enough is the impact that conflict has on young people. You just think about kids that are raised in environments where they've never really known what it's like to not constantly, as I said earlier, be in fear or feel like there's some type of a threat there. We are seeing this all over the world, obviously. But even think about a country like Afghanistan. We've been at war there for 13 years. We know that for decades before that. The Russians were there. I mean, this is a country that has constantly been in a state of conflict. And I just think that psychologically we have to kind of tap into how this affects young people, how they think about their prospects for the future, what the possibilities might be, how it affects their entire development, and to go back to what Bill was saying earlier, talk about that hope gap. So maybe you could give us some thoughts on that.
Absolutely. I think Bill said it very well. There is an incredible long-term impact and undocumented impact that conflict has on youth. Jordan is an excellent example where you see Syrian refugees flowing in just unbelievable numbers into Jordan, and you have children there who are growing up with this as the context of all that they know, and it compounds everything else, the economic problems, the health problems, obviously mental health issues, and can have an incredible effect perpetuating conflict itself. Again, because of a sense of that's what they know, and that's the world that they expect into the future. And this is where, whether it's business looking at political risk and whether to invest, or it's looking at how to break that cycle, this is where governance is incredibly important. And an index like this isn't going to solve that problem, but it can help to really illuminate those issues of participation, in democratic institutions, how much the governments are building a middle class, what kind, and that helps whether you're a public investor like USAID or you're a private investor, it helps you think about where are the areas where this country or this area, this region, really can grow and improve and break some of these cycles of conflict, and where do we need to help to get them in the right place before it's a healthy environment in which to have the youth grow up and again, have a different future than what they probably anticipated early on.
And I don't want to get too much into the weeds of the actual content of the report here, because I know that we're going to have a lot of a full presentation of it, and there will be a response panel. But just one more question regarding that too, Kathleen. I was looking at Russia, for example, right? My family is from there. I was born there, and so I find it particularly interesting. And Russia is one of these countries that just didn't make sense to me on the Youth Wellbeing Index when you look at it, because it is as incredibly high level economically, and yet when it comes to the security in the country, the situation is very poor, at least according to the rankings here. So how do we make sense of that?
Well, I haven't gone into the details of the report, okay. So I don't want to make a snap judgment on Russia. I will say there are a number of countries where you have these disparities. A couple were highlighted in the video, where they may be doing particularly well on one piece of the index and not on the others. And I think that's where it's really providing data for researchers to go in and start to look at that and try to understand how that data is, how you interpret that. In the case like Russia, obviously the biggest concern from the security perspective we have about governance in Russia is on its democratic institutions, its freedom of the press, all those areas that we know historically those desires need to be met for a country, regardless of its economic path, to successfully transition, its economy to its fullest potential. So my suspicion is in a case like Russia or several other states, what you might be looking at is states in transition, essentially. And the question is, will they succeed in those transitions? And how does this index help us think through that? Or are they bound to have a period of sustained stagnation or even decline? And so watching that index over time will be very important, too, to see how the factors shift from year to year. It's very hard to judge anything based on a single snapshot.
Okay. Bill, I'm curious too how young people, I think we get a little bit of a bad rap sometimes, especially everyone likes to talk about millennials and how they're so self-entitled, and you can call this first world problems, as many people do, but I think that's important, right? It applies. This is one of the things that is very different as you look at this index, at the different countries. For some, it's about the basics of just having a safe place to call home and having food and water security, and then for obviously more advanced economies, it becomes more about, I think, some of these desires, the trust in institutions, as you were saying, Kathleen, too, and in the ability to take advantage of democracy, take part in it. It goes all the way up to the media, to my profession, to, you know, whether you have faith in the information that's being given out to you. And so, because the world is becoming so much more interconnected, mass communication is something that has been completely redefined thanks to technology. Do you think that the way that we talk about well-being, what that means for young people, is fundamentally changing?
They'll tell us. You know, I think you say young people get a bad rap. Sometimes they have no rap because they're not in the room and participating in the conversations. And we tried very much to bring young people in to have their views part of the different discussion groups that led to these domains and indicators. Secondly, it's just part of our philosophy and others that subscribe to the positive youth development theory that what you're really doing is arming young people and helping them develop their own skills so that they make the right decisions for their futures, looking at young people then as really the protagonists in their own development and thus their community and nation's development and not just beneficiaries of well-meaning middle-aged philanthropies and government agencies that want to help them. So they're very much, and then I think to make sure that there was this psychological well-being, their aspirations, their sense of hope as part of the index, rather than just going to infant mortality and graduation rates and employment rates, was very important. And we expect to have that kind of dialogue. It's just part of our DNA, the way we work. But I think it's more and more what young people are not only wanting, but my generation was the generation that said we don't trust anyone over 30. This generation under 30 is much smarter than we were. They want to have relations with people over 30. They just want the authenticity and the space and the legitimacy to have those relationships, and we need to listen to them and have them part of our conversations.
Embedded in the question and in the answer is, a point worth emphasizing, which is none of this is really going to be particularly effective without full engagement from youth in the process, not just the index, but the whole process of continuing to gather more data and then making decisions on how you're going to allocate the resources, as I keep talking about. And I think, you know, based on my experiences over the years with Bill and his team, that's a real issue. I can't tell you, Bill can probably speak to it more eloquently than I, what the root cause of it is. I mean, you sort of implied some of it in the question, but we will not succeed at any of what we're trying to do without a full engagement from youth, because in the end, yes, having a bunch of no offense to all of us middle-aged people trying to decide what's good for youth is important. There's experience in the room, and there's, you know, a history, and having been through all these stages in life. But ultimately, the world is different for all a lot many of the reasons you described. And things are moving at hyperspeed and in a very different way than when all of us were youth. And we need to understand those perspectives. They need to be at the table, in my opinion, in a much bigger way than they are today.
And I think that really taps into the, you know, in order to see young people take the energy and the desires and the wishes that they have and harvest that in the proper way, they need to feel like they're working with partners that they can trust, rather than having this lead and tilt in the opposite direction, where we see unrest lead to less stable situations and to more violent situations. And so on that note, you know, Chris, you were saying that employability is something that is very important for a company like Hilton. The tourism industry is huge. You are a worldwide, global company. And yet you often notice a considerable skill gap in this demographic of young people that you are hoping to employ. And so, you know, part of my question here is, what do you think how much of a role should private businesses, private industry play in trying to educate and train young people,
be a
partner for them
that
way?
I think we, you know, would be better if the basic, being honest as a person running a business, it would certainly be my choice if I had it, that the basic systems of how youth are educated, both in the family environment and then more formal education throughout their lives, would prepare them to come walk in the door and start working for us. The simple truth of the matter is, in most parts of the world, that's just not happening, both because of breakdown in the family unit and education, you know, education systems that are not up to snuff. So again, out of necessity, I think we feel like we have to. This is a lot of the reason that, you know, IYF and Hilton Worldwide found each other. I mean, and it isn't, it is more basic than many would think. It's not the skills that are you know, sort of even vocational skills. I mean, those are issues. It's life skills. I mean, in many parts of the world, it's understanding literacy, numeracy, hygiene, you know, how to work as part of a team, how to show, I mean, you're going to laugh, but how to show up at work on time, right? That, you know, that in fact, if you don't, you know, have certain level of responsibility and accountability, you know, you can't really be part of the work environment. And you'd be surprised, but in many, many parts of the world, those basic, you know, sort of what I, you know, life skills don't exist. So much of the work we're doing, you know, with Bill on Passport to Success in Saudi Arabia, South Africa, particularly coming out of some meetings I had with President Zuma, is really focused on the most rudimentary sort of life skills, because we think we do a really good job if they have those basic skills and training people. The other thing in our business, this probably, you know, we don't have enough time for it, but a longer discussion, is recognizing that jobs in the travel and tourism industry are good jobs. I mean, one of the biggest things that we fight, not just in the Western world, but even in the emerging markets with all this unemployment, is that the youth, for whatever reason, whether it's a function of, you know, what they've learned from others around them, their families and parents, there's a belief that these are not good jobs, that they're dead-end jobs, and you know, that they're entry-level, you know, sort of back of house, and they're dirty jobs, and they don't want them. Nothing could be further from, by the way, we all start at the bottom. I started down the street at the Holiday Inn in the engineering department. I run the biggest hotel company in the world. I started at the very, very bottom of the business. Now, I went and got an education. I did a lot of things. But we have tens of thousands of stories in our business of people. If you went out, and I did it the other day, I was in a room with 500 of our general managers, and I said, you know, how many of you started at the lowest levels? And I don't, a very large percentage of the hands in the room went up. These are people that are running big businesses, and they started at the bottom. So there is a line of sight to something better. And by the way, you have to start somewhere, and you have to sort of get in and be willing to learn and grow and be trained and those sorts of things. So it's a combination of things for us. It's basic life skills, but it's also, in a way, you know, changing the paradigm and helping youth understand, marketing a bit to the youth that these are not dead-end jobs, that these are, like anything, you got to start somewhere, and that if you work hard and you build your skill sets and you work as part of a team, you can go on and do bigger and better things.
All right, we have just a few minutes left here, so I'd love to hear both Kathleen and Bill from you. And Kathleen, just very quickly, what do you think that priorities on the parts of governments really tell young people, right? I mean, I think that we can look at our own government as an example there, and the constant debate that we're having over defense spending and whether or not we can throw any cuts in that direction towards the Pentagon, or whether we can continue to fund social programs, and if anything, we've really seen a lot of those social programs get the axe recently, and I think that plays into you know, everything that we've been talking about here, and it's not just the family unit, but it's the opportunities and the structures that are there to support young people all the way through, and so, again, you know, how do you think that affects young people when they look at and see for themselves, or make their own decision on what they think the priorities are on the part of their government?
I think it's an incredibly important question. You're asking a security person to make a guns versus butter argument, and I won't do that. I don't think, in the case of the United States in particular, that we, as the nation, the great nation that we are, that we have to make those choices quite that starkly. Of course, there are critical choices to be made. But let me say this. I think it is incredibly important, again, for youth to feel that their voices are heard in that process, no matter their personal views of what the outcome will be. And again, the youth are not a monolith. They'll have their own wide variety of viewpoints on what the right choices are. So what really matters is government institutions, government processes that allow those voices to be heard. obviously, if you're looking at the stability and security of any nation, you do look to some basic factors. You are looking at their security structures, how apolitical are they, how much do they follow the rule of law. Rule of law itself in society is a major factor. And again, this gets to the issue of youth ability to participate and feel that the society is just to them. You get issues of infrastructure. You have to have a healthy infrastructure. You have to have good education. You have to have an economy that allows for participation and ability to grow from the lowest classes up through the middle class and have the greatest aspirations be fulfilled. So that's a lot to ask, and it's probably beyond the means of any country right now in the world. But I think to the extent that we continue to focus on those sorts of goals and work out the balance at any given time based on the whatever the environment, geostrategic and domestic political in the case of the United States, will allow, I think you can get to a place where youth feel invested, they feel that they can turn to the institutions of society rather than to violence as a means to create change, and that's what we're looking for.
All right, and Bill, finally, as we said, this is the first ever Global Youth Wellbeing Index. This is a starting point. But in order to be able to compile more data in the future, to better understand what it is that both differentiates and ties together young people and their experiences worldwide, what are the most important aspects to getting cooperation both from governments and from private entities and actually from young people themselves, wherever it is that they may be lying here, so that this can continue to happen annually so that we can really fill out this information better?
Well, I think part of it is the spotlight that Chris was talking about, that we need at these major forums to understand that this is a problem. It is a huge problem bringing young people into the economy and with hope for the future. And that's not a Pollyanna type thing. There are real things that can be done, and an index can help us understand where to invest. The index is not a silver bullet. We will need more data. We will need more experiences. But if it can raise the level of dialogue about effectively understanding the environment so you make those right decisions and then measuring the outcomes of them, and I think it plays very much into the discussion we're all having now, from security to development to all sorts of reasons, about the post-2015 goals. We have President Obama and President Kim of the World Bank talking about eradicating extreme poverty by 2030. It won't happen. It won't happen if there is not economic growth that brings young people into the economy so that they work their way out of poverty. 1 billion people have escaped poverty in the last 20, 30 years, the largest number in history. How have they done that? Well, they've gotten jobs, and jobs that are maybe starting at the bottom but working their way up. How many people in this room started at the bottom in their careers? But today's teenagers or young adults will be in their mid-30s by 2030. If they're not employed at a much higher rate than their parents are today, and their children who are getting born today or will be born soon will be the teenagers entering the job market in 2030. If those numbers aren't way up there, in other words, if the economic part, we can school and make healthy all the kids in the world, and that's part of the index and very important. But if the outcome isn't also a viable economic actor who can get a job, keep a job, start a business, make it succeed, however small, maybe informal, later on becoming a formal one, we will have failed. And those 2 billion people out there won't join the working and middle class of the world. If they do join, let me tell you, there will be jobs for everyone because there will be more consumers. Will that create some environmental issues for us? Yes. But we'll at least have an employed work base and a tax base in these countries such that then you could tackle those other big problems like global warming. But we've got to bring 2 billion people out of poverty, and that's only going to come through economic growth, inclusive growth, and it really means young people getting jobs that they can keep. Start at the bottom for the most part, yes, but see that line of sight to a career.
All right, well, that'll do it for our plenary panel here, but I want to thank you all.
Hey, we're good peg, too.
thank you so much. And Nicole Goldin now will present the actual details here.
Thank you. Great. Well, thank you so much, Alyona, and thank you, Chris, Bill, and Kath, for so insightfully setting the stage for me to now share a few more details about the index. Some of the points were already hit on, so I'll have a chance to flesh them out a little bit more and add a little bit of my own spin, if you will. And just to thank you all again for being here. I'm really honored to be able to share the stage with our opening distinguished speakers and our distinguished speakers to come, and really to share this day with all of you, so many friends and colleagues and guests here with us. Before getting into the detail of the report, I did want to take a minute to recognize two very important people that helped us be here today. One is Payal Patel. If you can stand and wave, Payal Patel. And Catherine, Katie Perry, standing in the back, for their very hard work and significant contributions to this project, and also to Katie for doing the lion's share of organization of this event. I see many very youthful faces in the audience today, and I'm thinking that everybody's wondering, who are the youth in the Youth Wellbeing Index? This was touched upon by Alyona and Chris in particular. And everyone's wondering, do I qualify? Am I a youth? So we did get started on that conversation, but I just want to flesh that out a little bit. To start, we say the youth is not necessarily definable by age. You don't wake up on a certain birthday with joy and excitement and say, yes, I am a youth today. Although I do know from personal experience, you are much more likely to be told when you are no longer a youth. We recognize, as has been said, that youth is a life stage. It's as much a social construct as it is a term of science to discuss, evaluate, and assess a diverse population group, as has been said, that's maturing emotionally, physiologically, and cognitively. It's a group experiencing transitions, as Bill mentioned, of their lives in various ways on the road to adulthood. Youth, as has been said, comes to include adolescents, teens, young adults, and is most often used synonymously with young people. But when it comes to statistics on youth, to global statistics on youth, the global data most often, but not exclusively, captures those ages 15 to 24. And so for that reason, a number of our youth-specific data sets in the index cover 15 to 24, but some of our youth survey data goes from a range of 12 to 21. So you'll see the youth-specific survey data in the index is in that range. However, as has been mentioned, given that on a national level, youth policy and programs are often designed to reach younger adolescents or even older youth, younger adults, we suspect that the policy and programmatic implications of the index will reach a broader scale. Our framework for youth well-being is rooted in theories of change and human development for both individuals and countries. Our approach to well-being has been informed by measures of poverty and development that have moved from interpretations that were once more strictly defined by economic growth or income to ones that are more multidimensional and that seek to include both objective and subjective and behavioral elements of well-being. Our approach to youth well-being, more specifically, as Bill mentioned, is informed by the theory and practice of positive youth development. And what we know about what matters from best practice, what matters for young people's success. Our final selection of the indicators and associated data sets was informed by expert and stakeholder consultations. We actually engaged some 50 different experts from 35 different organizations, and we included a global review to ensure that, to the extent possible, we were reflecting youth experiences in various regions of the world. We're very lucky to have with us today for our response panel two contributors, Manny Jimenez from the World Bank and Angga Martha from UNFPA Indonesia, who we're very happy to hear their thoughts. But I'm also very happy to see in the room a number of other participants and contributors to the index. Too many to name, but if I can see you all, if I can just ask you to wave so we can again say thank you. I see a number of you in the room. So what's in the index? As you've been mentioned and as you saw in the video, the index is comprised of six interconnected domains or spheres of a young person's life: citizen participation, economic opportunity, education, health, information and communications technology, and safety and security. I was wondering if they were going to mix up the bubbles and see if I can do them out of alphabetical order, but I'm glad to see that they didn't. I might have forgotten one. Together, the domains comprise of 40 indicators that assess well-being as a factor of opportunities provided by their environment and how they are, what and how they are doing, and importantly, how they feel about it. More specifically, as has been mentioned, and Kath touched on this, we look at three different kinds of indicators as contributing to youth well-being. We look at factors that speak to how the overall environment is supporting young people, things like macroeconomic climate, ICT infrastructure, public spending on education, or levels of peace. We look at specific youth outcomes and how the young people are doing at this time, things like volunteering among youth, or youth unemployment, as we've talked about, or the number one cause of youth death worldwide, road and traffic accidents. And again, importantly, we look at youth satisfaction and youth outlook, how young people are feeling about how they're doing, and these are based on surveys of young people. And these include indicators like outlook towards government, wealth expectations, or even their own perceived levels of stress, which, as we've seen, has a huge impact on their well-being and their future. The data in the index is drawn from a number of public and independent sources and from existing data sets. 98% of the data is from 2008 or later. So we tried to keep it to as recent a time period as we could. But as been mentioned in the earlier panel, though there is a lot in the index, and I'm hoping that you'll all take the time to read the report and hear more about how we construct it and what the important findings are, we know that the index, as been said, can't tell us everything we need to know at this time. And there are some limitations, and I think it's important to take a minute and talk about what's not in the index. In the first sense, as has been mentioned, we know that young people are a diverse population group, and they share differences and commonalities, and that often reflect the societies and communities in which they live. And as been mentioned, we know that their individual quality of life is likely shaped by their gender, socioeconomic status or class, marital status, religion, disability, language group, or sexual orientation. We know, for example, that young men and young women experience different outcomes and different levels of equity in terms of education performance or education enrollment or interpersonal violence, and that rural youth and urban youth often face different challenges and have varying opportunities and access to services. Ideally, the index could account for these differences, but such disaggregated data, as we mentioned, isn't available at scale at this time. But as Chris noted, we see the index as a point of departure, however. We hope to use the index as a framework for deeper dives at the country level or regional level where such data may exist and where such analysis may be possible. Also, a number of indicators that we considered were not included in the end. Some for technical reasons, some for data reasons. In particular, several youth-specific outcome measures that we would have liked to include weren't in the end. In the report, you'll see a short discussion of youth voting or the need for better, more concrete measures, education and learning and skills outcomes measures. But there were a number of other ones that we considered, including real levels of youth poverty around the world, better measures of the better data on access to or knowledge of contraception, more robust measures of civic participation and education, and better measures of youth mobile use. But this inaugural index does cover 30 countries from high to low income in 5 major regions that represent nearly 70% of the world's youth population, in this case, ages 10 to 24. So what did we find out? We started to hearing about some of the key findings in the video, one of which being that we find that a majority of youth are experiencing low or lower levels of well-being. This is a big statement, so let me break that down a bit, and excuse me if I get a little bit technical here. The rankings themselves are based on calculated scores between 0 and 1. The overall composite score is built from the 6 domains, and the domain scores are weighted calculations from the individual indicators. And again, you can see more about this technical detail in the report and in the methodology report online. But the overall index average score is 0.58, with 12 countries falling above that average and 18 below. And those 18 countries hold about 85% of the represented youth in the index. So we started with the big statement, but that's a little bit more granularity. And many of those countries are the developing economies and the fragile states that we talked about in the earlier panel. But however, even where youth are doing well generally, they may not be thriving in all respects and may not be as positive about their state of affairs. And similarly, as was mentioned in the video, youth in less wealthy nations or countries ranking in the lower tiers display success in certain areas and may be more optimistic than their environments or outcome data would suggest. Vietnam outranks its lower middle income peers, driven by particularly high scores in economic opportunity and health. Overall, as you can see in the results, Australia is at the top, Nigeria comes in at 30th, and the US comes in at 6th. The countries are also grouped into 4 performance-based tiers on distribution around the average score, and you can see those by the change in color in this table. The tiers, the 4 tiers, high well-being, upper middle well-being, lower middle, and low, add another level of analysis, of comparison, and could encourage collective response. And as we're about to see, are a way to easily visualize trends and patterns. The high performers are all high-income OECD nations, which is not necessarily surprising given that a number of the indicators are infrastructure or resource-driven, where wealthier countries are likely to do well. But as I point out a few of the other results, I encourage you, if you are online, to follow along interactively on our newly live website, www.youthindex.org. So you can have a chance to see this and interact with it now or when you get back to your desk this afternoon. The well-being tiers are displayed by colors from light to dark, with dark being the highest level of well-being. And you can notice in this map of the overall index score that patterns of well-being generally correlate with national income more than they do with geography. Countries of the Asia-Pacific and Europe rank in each of the 4 tiers. Countries of the Americas in 3 of the tiers, and the Middle East, North Africa, and Sub-Saharan Africa cross into 2 tiers each. But taking a look at the domains, let's turn first to health, which includes the largest number of indicators, 9. With the highest average score of the 6 domains at 0.67, we think results here perhaps demonstrate that global investments in health systems, childhood nutrition, and fighting disease are starting to pay off. In fact, 2/3 of the countries in the health domain actually fall above this global average. Other notable performers in the health domain vis-a-vis their performance otherwise particularly include Saudi Arabia and Jordan. And again, you'll be able to see in the site each of the countries' performance box. The U.S. tops the ranks in economic opportunity. But perhaps not surprisingly, given how hard young people were hit by the global recession, as has been mentioned, and by the current global unemployment crisis, economic opportunity scores generally are the weakest of all the domains and has the lowest average within the index of 0.47. This domain includes 7 indicators. And interestingly, again, while the U.S. scores very well on the enabling and outcome measures, which would indicate a supportive environment and relatively robust opportunities vis-a-vis the rest of the world, American youth, like so many others of their peers around the world, express low expectations about their economic prospects. Speaking to our finding that outlook or aspirations don't necessarily always align with what the objective data may say. Also, perhaps not surprisingly, given the emphasis on infrastructure among the 5 indicators in the information and communications technology domain, we see the broadest range of scores, with South Korea at the top with 0.94 and Uganda at the bottom with just 0.18. So it's a very interesting patterns and very, very large diversity of access and opportunity in ICT. Citizen participation and, to a certain degree, safety and security are interesting in part for their incongruity to a certain degree with the other domains. In citizen participation, many of the top OECD and wealthier countries drop in rankings, and countries in the bottom ranks otherwise rise to the top behind Colombia, including South Africa, India, and Tanzania. And I'm very much looking forward to hearing from Ambassador Rasool in our next panel. In safety and security, while this domain average is actually the second highest after health, it also has the largest number of low performers, with 9 in that low-performing tier, indicating that many countries are still grappling to provide that protective environment and keep young people safe. Notable divergence here from otherwise stronger performance includes weaker scores among the Americas, Brazil, Mexico, and Colombia, particularly and perhaps not surprisingly, and underperformance vis-a-vis otherwise strong scores from Saudi Arabia. But again, Tanzania and Ghana do relatively well here. So what does this all mean? We are about to hear from a very distinguished panel of stakeholders, but allow me to offer a quick few thoughts that they may respond to, and again, follow up on some of the insights that were already raised this morning. For policymakers, we see this really as a twofold opportunity. For policymakers in countries in the index, we hope that the findings will help them assess whether and how their policies, institutions, and services are meeting youth's needs, and to help them identify areas where they may need reform. But we also think this index will be useful and applicable for countries not currently included in the index. We hope it will serve as an inspiration, if you will, and a framework for their own internal assessments and analysis of youth well-being that could then better inform their policy decisions. I'm also pleased to see so many friends and colleagues from the implementing community in the world, and in the room. And we hope that the index will aid in your efforts in strategic planning. And as you go forward in your broader exercises, and also help align macro level outcomes and inform your advocacy efforts. As has been said, we all have a role to play in ensuring that the world's youth thrive. For public and private donors, we believe the index can inform strategies, as Chris has mentioned, and priorities and frameworks for investment, so that they are better directed to where there is the greatest need. And as partnerships are critical, we expect the results can help forge mutual understanding of youth needs and aspirations to convene parties and leverage resources. But last and certainly not least, and I'm glad that this came up in our first conversation, we hope that the world's young people will find the index and its results useful to inform and validate their own positions so that they can find synergies with their peers, more powerfully advocate for themselves and with their partners, governments, and in the international community. And while we anticipate that all stakeholders will primarily respond in their immediate communities and countries, we hope the index will inform the broader global economic, political, and social agenda, and as Bill mentioned, and particularly the post-2015 development framework. And we make a number of recommendations that can be acted upon globally, as you may say. We highlight the need to pay closer attention to and collect more data on youth satisfaction and outlook and aspirations, including youth participation and elevating youth voices. The index also uncovers, as we've indicated, as we've started to spotlight, areas where greater data collection on youth outcomes and more age disaggregated data in particular is still needed. And the index highlights the interconnectedness between indicators and domains to encourage more coordinated planning, more coordinated policies, more cross-sectoral programs, so we can see holistic youth well-being go forward. So as I've been going through this, I hope many of you may have already joined the social media conversation about the index on #youthwellbeingindex. And we also hope that you will continue to explore the index on www.youthindex.org, our new website that went live this morning. On the website, you can find the country profiles, all of the reports, as well as the fabulous video that you can watch again and share. So with that, I'm happy to take a few questions now before we break for some networking and continuing on with the questions. So we'll take, World Bank style, as my colleagues say, we'll take 3 questions. I see a hand here, this gentleman, and then we'll go to Nikki in the back. This gentleman here, yeah, is the mic coming?
I founded the Muslim Jewish Conference, which brought together by now 400 leaders or young leaders. There we go. 400 young leaders from about 40 countries, bringing together Muslims and Jews. And what I saw was that these people, who were well below their 30s usually, tend to create their own innovative networks of cooperation. So my question is, if you look into the more less developed countries, why not start at the more developed countries and look at what we actually do with our youth? I see 100,000 programs of young leaders, but these young leaders don't really lead anything or decide anything. They have to do about 15 internships, go into, I don't know, years of study. By the time that they actually come to a point where they could decide something or take a risk, they're already well in their 30s. And start to work in some organization or company. So there are a lot of politicians or other people who are invested in at a level where they didn't deliver yet, and I don't understand why youth isn't also in a position where there's a lot of funding directed towards them, so they can make mistakes, but they can also lead and make their own decisions and actually come up with the solutions that maybe our generation just doesn't think about anymore.
Thank you. Let me quickly try to address that question, and again, hopefully we'll have time for some others. I think it's a great point, and what we've seen from the index is that there are lessons to be learned, I think, everywhere in the world. As we said, there are pockets of success in the more advanced economies, and there are pockets of success, particularly when it comes to participation and leadership in some of the developing world, as you say. We hope that this index, as I mentioned, can be a tool to bring that conversation together. And to your point about increasing investment in youth, that's exactly what we're all about. But we need to have a better understanding of where the gaps are and where the lessons are and what that understanding is so that we can move forward. We hope that we hope that young people will see this as a tool and find it useful in their conversations, and we'll be happy to be part of that conversation with you and your network and the other networks that you want to bring together. So thank you, and thanks for being here. Is a good question behind you?
Hi, my name is Nicole Cheatham, and I'm with Advocates for Youth. I'd like to thank Hilton, the International Youth Foundation, CSIS, for investing in this and making this youth index happen. So my question is related to its application, and I know we have a colleague from UNFPA speaking in a bit, but given all of the work that's being done around the post-2015 development agenda and UNFPA's push to get a sustainable development goal on youth, I was wondering if there have been discussions about that and if the index, perhaps as it's expanded, could be a tool in measurement along those lines.
Thank you. It's a great question. We've certainly, as we've said, we have been developing this index along with, if you will, the developing conversation around the post-2015 agenda. And we drew on many of the indicators that we include were some of the few that were part of the current MDGs, but hope that we can inform and influence the conversation going forward. We see the MDGs, the post-2015 framework, particularly the targets, almost more so than the broad goals themselves, as a real opportunity to encourage and include youth, particularly those youth-specific, age-disaggregated, not to get too technical and wonky, but those age-disaggregated indicators as part of the post-2015 MDG frameworks, because that will encourage the data collection that we need to better monitor and better inform index like our index going forward. As I said, several data points that we wanted to include, there just wasn't the data at scale and globally. And again, so I think it's a great point. We know our friends in the UN are paying close attention. We've received a wonderful statement that's on the website from the UN Secretary General's Special Envoy on Youth, Ahmed Al-Andawi, who unfortunately couldn't be with us today. And so we're engaged in that conversation. We hope to continue to be in that conversation, and we hope that the index can help inform and influence it as well. So thank you. And we're looking forward to Anga's comments on that following the break. Time for one more. Katie, right in front of you.
Thank you very much for a wonderful presentation. My question is about what are we looking at, particularly perhaps to Bill and Chris and you as well, that what are we looking as enabling solutions for the youth? How are you getting this message out to them? And as we talk about holistic and whatnot, you're looking at 75 million that is not going to necessarily be as privileged as all of us are sitting in here and able to watch you alive or not. So what are the enabling solutions that you're looking for? Thank you.
Thank you. I'm not necessarily going to answer that question, but there's a reason, and I'm being a little bit cheeky here, as they say. We think the solutions need to be driven by really, you know, the policymakers and the young people and the private sector decision makers in the countries coming together, but hopefully utilizing this data to better understand, again, where the reforms need to be, where are the gaps, where are the enabling environments not serving young people, where are young people not receiving the services, the training, the education, the access to health that they need. And so the solutions that we kind of offer and the recommendations are to policymakers and with specifics to the enabling environment to look at this data, help use it to help identify the gaps, to go deeper and think about, look at what other specific policy solutions may be working, and then take those on as they are relevant and suitable in their countries. We see this as that spark to that thoughtful dialogue and continued deeper dive discussion that will happen, again, at the country level and at the global level. And we just hope that this will sort of inform that conversation. But as I said, one of the things we do see, though, is the need, given the interconnectivity between these domains, to think about enabling environments and the policies in particular, and our colleagues in the programming community will hopefully, again, take this information forward at the more sort of ground game, or if you say the ground level, but to think about, again, this interconnectivity within youth lives, and to think about how economic policies and education policies interact and how they should be thought about in perhaps a more holistic way, how health actually and the health of young people is critically important to their economic productivity. So it's all interlinked to think about how you need to and why you need to engage young people in conflict and fragile environments in that conversation so that they feel like they have a better stake and say in their future. So that's from an enabling environment perspective, that is something that, you know, we do offer and we do say. I think I've got time for one more on this side. Colleague Mark Summers.
Thanks, Nicole. First of all, I think this is really a groundbreaking effort, and I want to congratulate you and your supporters, the people who have helped to put this together. We've never had this before, and there hasn't been a baseline, and now there is. There's a reference point. I wanted to encourage you as you go forward for these deep dive ideas. I think there's a concern I have about homogenizing youth as populations and market opportunities. If we look at Africa, it's estimated that for youth, 90% of all future jobs are in the informal sector. With youth populations, the issue of inequality is really a profound one, and there's a big difference. And I'm concerned about when you mentioned the youth, when that happens a lot, my concern is that opportunities are going to go to well-off youths, which will unintentionally expand inequality. And the last one is gender. I think it's really important. You know, in a lot of countries, female youth are barely considered youth. And in the research I've been doing in Africa, a real at-risk population are single female youth with children. And if there's a way to try to get at some of these things when you do the deep dive, I think this can be useful not just for those countries, but for other countries concerned about youth. Thank you.
Thanks, Mark. No, absolutely. I mean, I really couldn't agree more with your thoughts and your statement. We agree. We looked at, you know, when we were putting this together, would we be able to, as part of the overall Youth Wellbeing Index, be able to break it down and offer a sort of, you know, gendered analysis of the whole thing. And while many of the indicators are available by both sex and age desegregation, many are not. But to your point, that is an area where we would hope to do further analysis. Your point about inequality is very well taken, and again, it's something that we thought about. We looked at as and considered and looked for possible indicators that spoke to, even if not youth-specific, as part of this kind of enabling environment, that spoke to inequality within sectors. But really outside of Gini coefficients on the sort of economic inequality, sector-based inequality measures don't really exist, as I said, for the youth population or for any population. So, you know, I'd love to see an education. There are some efforts being made around education inequality and being able to sort of measure and capture that within a society. But there aren't great measures on health inequality within countries, again, at scale in a comparative way. I think were those different sector measures available, it's something we would certainly, you know, think about and consider for the future. I think it's an incredibly important point. And again, back to the post-2015 millennium, the MDG framework, we know inequality is certainly coming up in those conversations as well, and it's something that they're trying to tackle and will hopefully be successful. But it's a tough one because, again, we don't have as much of a baseline as we need. So we'll hope to be able to get into that at the country and regional level. But thank you. It's been a pleasure. With that, we unfortunately have to go for a break. I'll be available for a few more questions, and then we'll be reconvening at 11. We'll pause for a short break. Of course, there's coffee. Thank you all for joining us so far, but please stay tuned. There's so much more to come.